Welcome to another Tropical Web Show. I am not in my 80s basement, but that does not mean we don't have a very 80s-tastic interview for you. I have been wanting to chat to this man for so long. Michael Klastorin, the production publicist for so many iconic movies, including the epic Back to the Futures 2 and 3. He has a book out on Back to the Future. He also has a new book out on Back to the Future, the musical. If you have not booked tickets yet, make sure you do. I hope you enjoy this interview as much as I enjoyed talking to him. And don't forget where we're going. That's Charlie the Cat. We don't need roads. So welcome to my web show, Michael. How are you?
Well, thank you. I'm very happy to be here, and I'm doing well.
Good to hear. First of all, could you describe what I've heard it referred to as a production publicist, a unit publicist. What is it that you do for films with films?
The term unit publicist is kind of outdated now, and we're trying to just be known as production publicists, and that really is descriptive of the job. It's being on set, being with the production while it's being shot, and to deal with any number of issues, either attracting or keeping away publicity, writing materials at the studio or whoever is going to use to distribute to the media, biographies, stories about the show and the people involved, working with a photographer to make sure that everyone's getting the proper photos that will ultimately be needed. And then also working with whatever studio is producing the show needs in terms of their post-production and pre-opening needs and wants. So it keeps you busy.
And you were on set every single day to do this? Are you involved in pre-production, post-production, or just the actual shooting of the film?
A couple of weeks of pre-production and a couple of weeks of post-production, but pleasure to be on set every day. If they're shooting, I'm going to be there because I have to document, much as you know, you want all the opportunities, all the knowledge that you can possibly get to be able to properly write about, talk about, and discuss whatever you're working on. So the longer I'm there, the more I'm going to get. And it's also good because I'm not the outsider on the crew. I may be a pain in the butt, but they're not going to say, hey, who's that guy over there? He only shows up for lunch. You know, if I need help, if I'm doing a photo shoot or having an interview and I need something from a grip or camera department, they're more likely to help me than they are some guy who just shows up every now and then. So I put in a lot of hours, and a lot of people are surprised how long I am on a set during the course of a shooting day, but that's the way I work and always have.
How did you get into it in the first place? Were you in high school loving movies and just went, you know what, I want to be a production publicist? Like, how did you even get
I don't think anyone has ever said that sentence or spoken those words, Lisa. I did always love movies, but I wrote reviews. I wrote film review for my high school and then college newspaper. And I made contacts within the business because I grew up in New York. So all of the studios had offices there, and I was afforded a lot of great interview opportunities and screenings and all that stuff. So I originally thought I maybe wanted to be a film critic, but then I met too many of them at screenings who were very jaded, and they said, oh God, I got to go see two screenings today and I'm tired. I didn't want to be that person. I love movies too much. So one of my contacts from my college writing helped get me an entry-level job at United Artists in New York. So that was my first job. And as I settled in there for about 2 years, I realized that I wanted to be on the production side. You know, it was really interesting work, and we had a lot of films to put out and a lot of tours and things like that. But I wanted to be there where the movie was being made, and to have an influence or just a part of being, you know, in that, having that experience. So I was lucky enough that one of the friends I had made at United Artists in New York, who was an attorney, was leaving the company to go produce his own movies. And he very graciously asked me if I would like to come along and be the publicist on his first film. That was the classic Wes Craven directed cult favorite Swamp Thing, starring Adrian Barbeau and Louis Jordan. That was my very first production credit.
How was that for the first time being on a set? You know, was it what you imagined? Was it better? Was it not as
good? I was panicked. I'd never done it before. I didn't know exactly what it was I was supposed to do. The very first day we were filming in Charleston, South Carolina, it was around a swamp, and all of the production vehicles and the trailers and everything was in a big field. And I was just sort of walking around looking, and Adrienne Barbeau popped her head out of her trailer and she said, "You look lost. You want to come in?" She just sat there. She was so sweet and warm and made me feel very welcome.
And you're best known, I would say, for your work with Back to the Future, which, I mean, what a way to be known. What was that whole experience like? I mean, obviously it continues with your books now and the musical, and I will ask you about that, but what was that experience like, just being involved in one of the greatest movie trilogies ever created?
Interestingly, I didn't work on part one, but very dear friends of mine were working on it. And at one point, the first AD, the assistant director, invited me to come visit the set. And I went down to Universal Studios, and they were filming the scene where in Lou's cafe, where George comes in, grabs his chocolate milk, and goes up to Lorraine. It was just tremendous fun watching everything happen. And there was Michael J. Fox over there, because this was after the whole Eric Stoltz debacle. And everyone was really working tightly and close together. And I just walked around that town square when they weren't filming. And I thought, boy, I would love to work on a film like this at some point. Little did I know that a few years later, I was working on a film called The Dream Team, which starred Michael Keaton and Christopher Lloyd, among others. Chris and I got to know each other a little bit. We got to be friends. When you work in production, at the end of any show, your conversation with everybody is usually, "So what are you doing next?" Because you're looking for work. And Chris told me he was going to be reprising the role of Doc Brown in Back to the Future 2. And he just casually said, "Would you like me to call Robert Zemeckis and recommend you?" You know, before he could stop the sentence, I said, "Yes, please." And a lot of times people will say those things, but they don't really mean it. But several months later, I found myself in the middle of Hill Valley, California, 1955. And over there was Doc and Marty. And I was part of this amazing family. At the time, it was just supposed to be Back to the Future 2. But then, as everyone knows, or anyone who's read my book, it got turned into Back to the Future 2 and 3. So spent the better part of a full year on those two films. And it was incredible. It was just incredible. I was living Back to the Future, and I was following Marty and Doc, and everything was just amazing. I was a kid in that proverbial candy store.
Was there one thing that you took away from working with that level of actors and filmmakers that you still use in work today, or some maybe life advice or work advice, career advice, something that you learned on that set that you still use today?
Gosh, I mean, I think you learn from every experience. And I've always been very conscious of my surroundings and where I am and what I'm in the middle of. And I want to make sure that I'm being helpful, but I'm also not being in the way. And there is such a thing called set presence. And one needs to learn it. And set etiquette is even a better way of describing it. It's knowing when you can approach people, knowing when you shouldn't approach people. It's knowing not to touch certain things. I was one of the few people who hadn't worked on part one, because most of the cast and crew came back from one, but they were very, very welcoming, and they treated me as if I had been part of the family from day one. And then I've been happily ensconced in that family through this very day and feel very blessed to be there.
Well, you mentioned your book. I have this one.
That one?
I have this one.
Wait a minute. I have that one.
Wow. I hear a great man wrote it. How does a book?
Who is he? I'll kill.
Was it your idea and you pitched to do it, or someone came to you? It was a natural pairing because you had done the publicity. How did the book happen?
The book happened in sort of two parts. At the end of Back to the Future 3, Universal had hired somebody to write sort of an oversized souvenir program book, which would be, you know, cover the three films and a little behind the scenes. And they brought in a writer from the UK. It was a UK publisher. They sent a writer in from the UK who stayed there for maybe 2 weeks on set of three, then went back to London and proceeded to write drafts of the book. And they would send it back to Bob Gale, and he was not happy with what was being written. There were a lot of factual errors and a few things, and he would very diligently give some corrections, and it would be sent back to him again, and there would be more errors and things. And he finally got fed up and asked me if I would be interested in rewriting it. And of course, you know, I said I would be honored to do so. And the publisher said, okay, fine, you know, you can do that. But here's the thing. We've already laid out the photos. So you have to write around them. And you only have a certain amount of words. You can't go one word over. But it was terrific. And I was very, very happy to write it and pleased how it turned out. But I always knew that it deserved more, that the trilogy... Here was this amazing trilogy, and nobody had given it, you know, a proper book. Indiana Jones had books, and Star Wars had books, and all of these other things, but no one had ever done Back to the Future. I told Bob Gale that I absolutely wanted to do that, so he was always behind me. And for many years, the problem was finding a publisher who would be able to pay the licensing fee to Universal Studios, which was... not something I could afford. Let's just put it that way. And then in 2013, found one. And that's when it started again. And I called Bob the minute I had a deal with them. And 15 minutes later, I got an email from him with a list of people he had already contacted who would be waiting for me to interview them. I refer to Bob ultimately as my godfather. Or when I need him in a pinch, my 800-pound gorilla who can help solve a problem that I can't. And happily, he loves both of those labels. I set at it. I went to Universal Studios, and I sat in their photo archives for 7 days straight and looked at every photo from all three movies, two of which I had known all the photos because I had seen them when they were being taken. And a lot of behind-the-scenes shots. I wanted to give the fans glimpses of things they hadn't seen. All these books usually have the same photos that you've seen from the studios in all of the websites, or, you know, back then it was magazines and newspapers, but they're always the same photo. There's always the picture of Harrison Ford and the Cobra in front of them that you've seen 9,000 times. And Back to the Future has its photos that are instantly recognizable. And I certainly wasn't going to ignore them, but I wanted there to be a lot of things that people had never seen and stories that had never been told. It took a while, but ultimately the book came out and people were very complimentary about it and embraced it, which also made me very, very happy.
I was going to ask, when you have a film so as popular as Back to the Future, you know that the fandom are serious fans. They will know everything and every bit of trivia, and they would know every photo off by heart. So it's good that the reaction was clearly positive. It's an incredible book. Were there any particular reactions or stories that you heard fans say that particularly touched you on what your book maybe meant to them?
People absolutely, they loved it. And you know, I was thrilled, because that's why it took so long to write. I wanted to get it right. Just before it was due to come out, we had done some previews and sent a couple of pages for websites. There, some of the comments were, I know everything Back to the Future. There's nothing anyone can tell me about Back to the Future that I don't already know. And later, I would see that same person came back and said, well, okay, yeah, there were a few things that maybe I didn't know. And you know, and I'm glad to have been able to not prove someone wrong, but to add to their knowledge and appreciation of the franchise. You know, a lot of people don't like to read reviews of their stuff. I'm able to take it with a grain of salt if someone didn't like something. But the worst criticism I ever got was that people didn't like the fact that the glue that was holding the little prop replicas in the book left a tiny mark. So if that's the worst that I had to deal with, I was good.
And this isn't your first Back to the Future related book, is it? You have created one on the musical. Could you talk about that? Because that musical is spectacular. So it was incredible. Could you talk about the book?
In 2020, I got a call from the publisher of the original book, and they wanted to know if I would be interested in doing a revision of it for the 35th anniversary. And that would be to add around 15, 20 pages. The book came out in 2015. They wanted me to update the book to show everything that had gone on between 2015 and 2020. A lot of what had happened was the musical. I, of course, said yes, and I, you know, talked it over with Mr. Gale. When I started doing the interviews for that revision, I talked to the director of the show, John Rando. I talked to Ollie Dobson, who played Marty, Roger Bart, who plays Doc, and a number of the other cast members. As I got into it, I realized there was so much material. It was so dense, and it deserved its own book. And I went back to Mr. Gale and I told him what I thought. He said, I think you're right. I think it does deserve its own book. And I found a publisher who thought that was a good idea. And so, and there you go. It was an experience I wasn't really prepared for, and not in a bad way. I come from a background in film. I became totally immersed in the world of the theater. And I've always been a theater fan, but until I went to London and sat through rehearsals and previews and everything that was going on surrounding this musical, I was just totally entranced by it. The thing with the show, it had its own issues. It opened officially in Manchester in early 2020, and 4 days after it opened, the world closed for COVID. The show, luckily, had been seen by a few people. They did, I forget the exact number, they did like 3 weeks of previews and four performances before the show had to close. So it was during time when the show had been closed that I did a lot of interviews, a lot of Zooming, and, you know, started putting things together. And it was great fun. And the musical left me just so exhilarated. You know, when you first hear, oh, they're doing a musical from Back to the Future. He's like, really? How's that going to work? And I had that little thought, but I also knew that with Bob Gale and Robert Zemeckis and Alan Silvestri and Glenn Ballard at the head of it all, it was going to be done right. Or as Bob Gale likes to say, or else we would push the red button and shut it all down. We weren't going to do it unless we did it right. And the results bear that out. They did it right. And now they're doing it right on Broadway as well. And getting ready next in 2024, it'll start rolling out in different cities in the States and soon overseas as well. And more people will get a chance to experience what is an amazing, brilliant piece of theater. And an amazing new chapter of Back to the Future.
I saw it and I loved it. And I had those same questions. How are they going to do the lightning strike? How are they going to do the DeLorean? And just, it was incredible. It was an incredible musical and it totally blew my mind. And I recommend it to everyone that I speak to. And it's one of the best ones that I've ever seen. And to capture the essence of the movie as well, and such a special movie, they did it so well.
And I think what's interesting is it took a long time. They first started talking about it in 2005, 2006. It took that long because it had to, because if it had gone into production in that early period, you wouldn't have had the same show that is now on stage with special effects, with the music, with everything, with the actors. It would have been a totally different show, and who knows how that would have been received. So it had to wait. It had to percolate. It had to brew. It had to steep for those years to give everybody the time that it needed and the opportunities. One would never imagine that anyone could replace Michael J. Fox or Christopher Lloyd in those roles. And they don't replace them. They honor them and they do their own takes. Ollie Dobson, who played Marty, was just absolutely a joy. And he immediately made you feel comfortable with the fact that he was Marty. Roger Bart is brilliant. He is a genius. And what is wonderful about the show and the entire cast and everybody involved is they love being there. You can see it in their performances. You can see it in their eyes. The first time I spoke to Roger Bart was by phone. I had seen a video of the first show in Manchester, which had been sent to me by Mr. Gale. And it was like from the back of the theater and one camera. It was the worst seats in the house. But I absolutely loved the show. And when I talked to Roger, I told him that I had seen the show on video and that I liked it. And he said, well, you know, I'm glad to hear that you liked it, but you haven't really seen the show. He said, you have to be in that room. You have to be with us. And he was right. I mean, because the experience is you're there with them in the same way that I was on set on Back to the Future 2, that first day, and there was Marty and there was Doc, and I went along on their adventure. That's what this is for audiences. They're along with everybody for this adventure. And it's a symbiotic relationship. The cast feeds from the audience reacts to the cast, and it makes everybody happier and better. I was thrilled to be able to share it, and I hope that this book about the musical gives people either a great memory of having seen the show or really good background about what they can expect. Because the show also has been designed so even if you haven't seen the movies, you can still enjoy it. And I, at one performance in New York, I sat next to this young woman who said, I've never seen the films. And I said, well, that's really interesting. So at the end of the show, when the curtain fell down, I turned to her and I said, well, she said, I'm going home to watch the movies now.
With your film critic hat on, why do you think Back to the Future has been as successful as it has?
The film has a heart. The film has a soul. It's an inspiring film. It doesn't beat you over the head with messages. It entertains. But at its heart, it's about family. It's about learning about yourself. And Back to the Future itself, the first movie, has often been referred to as the perfect film. There's really no argument there, from the screenplay to the acting to the casting to the direction to everything that went into it. There are so many people who love to tear things apart, and you don't find that with Back to the Future. It is, in Michael J. Fox's words, a movie about time travel, which is timeless. The movies just struck a chord with a lot of people, and it has become multi-generational.
Can you get a sense of when you're on set that the film is going to be successful or as iconic? You know, I believe Mad Money you worked on, and People versus Larry Flynt, and some really iconic movies. Do you know that they're going to be as big as they are when you're on set?
To a point. I mean, and it's just... It's a personal opinion. It's just a personal feeling, because I'm, you know, I cannot prognosticate. And if I could, I'd be rich. But there are some projects when you think, my gosh, this looks like so much fun. And I think it's going to be terrific. When I did The Lethal Weapon Part 2 and Part 3, those were tremendous fun. And I knew that everyone was going to enjoy them. People versus Flint was a really tremendous movie, and that was the first movie I did with Woody Harrelson. But you don't know. I thought it was going to be great. You had Milos Forman directing. You had Scott Alexander and Larry Karaszewski, brilliant writers who wrote the script. You know, they did Ed Wood and a number of other great movies. Woody was brilliant as Larry Flint. It looks great. And you're there and you're watching it, but you don't know what it's going to look like when it's done. And you don't know, is there an audience for a movie about Larry Flint? So, you know, there was, and it was very well lauded. I've been on some movies, and I won't name them, where I said, oh, this is bad. This is not going to go over well, and it hasn't, and some of them haven't. You know, I like to say that my resume goes from the sublime to the ridiculous, and I'm happy to have had every experience that I have, and I look forward to more. But you know, nobody knows what the future will bring. You're taking a chance. Even if you did Back to the Future 2, people are always looking at it with sort of a, really? Or is this just going to be a ripoff to make some more money? And no, it wasn't, it is the obvious answer. But there are a lot of sequels and films that are looking to just cash in. And when Zemeckis and Gale were approached by Universal to do Back to the Future 2, they weren't necessarily looking to. And nobody expected when they did the first movie, no one thought it was going to be as big as it was. You hope, certainly. I mean, and it certainly went through so many tumultuous times on its way to the theater. I mean, you know, one of the stories that I write about in the original book was Bob Zemeckis, who said after Eric Stoltz was let go and Michael was there, he said, of course, having Michael come in made a huge difference with everybody. But I was sure I was never going to work again in the business because of everything that had happened. And then the movie opened, and it wasn't like today when we have a movie open in 5,000 screens or, you know, some ridiculous number, because you have all the multiplexes. In those times, you had duplexes at the most, but the movie just kept going and going and going, and people kept going and going and going, and it was at the top of the box office charts for essentially a year. And then, of course, it was the biggest movie of 1985. I loved working on films like Zombieland. That was a terrific film and a lot of fun. And happily, everybody loved it.
Aside from Back to the Future, you just mentioned Zombieland, but aside from Back to the Future, what is one film that you've worked on, regardless of its success or not in the box office, that you personally found the most enriching or rewarding or memorable, for whatever reason that might be?
Well, apart from Back to the Futures, I would say Lethal Weapon 2. And that was for a number of reasons. The primary reason was the director, Richard Donner, who was one of the finest, not only one of the finest filmmakers ever, but one of the finest human beings that ever walked this earth. And I miss him every single day. He was a warm, brilliant, talented man who cared so much about not only the film that he was making, but the rest of the world as well. He had a lot of causes that he supported. He would put in these sly little Easter eggs about things that he was, you know, passionate about. Animal cruelty. You'd see a poster in the back of a police station about fur or whatever. He would just slip in these little things. And every member of his crew was important to him. Anybody could go up to him and make a suggestion or a comment, and he would take them to heart. He would never dismiss anybody. And even, you know, I would go up to him every now and then and say, "Hey, Dick, what if Riggs says this to Murtaugh?" And he would either laugh and say, "Okay, let's do it." Or he would explain to me why it was a good attempt, but it wouldn't fit in. It was never like, "Go away, get out of here." He was just an extraordinary person. And he made such a huge impression on me as a human being and as a professional.
Not a question, but just a side note. I was very lucky to interview him once in his office in LA, and I was such a huge fan and I was so in awe. But it surprised me. I mean, now I have met him and I hear people talk about him. I understand it, but at the time it surprised me that I had just called his office and said, "Can I interview him for a project?" And they went, "Sure, he'd love to chat." And I was like, "Richard Donner has time to chat, but that's great." And he was just the most welcoming, tall, booming voice, like generous man. And I can see why people speak of him like they do now.
He was. I mean, there was nothing like that voice and that laugh. And he had a little trouble with names, so he called everyone Kid. It's like, "How you doing, Kid? Good to see you, Kid." And you knew you really made it if he remembered your last name. And he would say, "Hey, someone get Klastorin in here." "What? He by name? Either he likes something I did or I'm in trouble." You know.
Is there a director that you haven't worked with that's on your bucket list, or an actor that you haven't worked with?
Oh, there's tons of them. I mean, I've been very fortunate. I've worked with a lot of amazing actors. There's always others that I'd like to work with. There's a couple I've worked with that I wish I hadn't. Again, no names. You know, I would like to do a movie with Mr. Spielberg as a director. I've certainly been around him. And I, in between my Back to the Future books, I did write a book about Close Encounters for its 40th anniversary. And Stephen spent many hours with me on it, which was just amazing to be able to tap into his memories and stuff. And he's always whenever I've asked him to contribute for the Back to the Future stuff, he has as well. I'm open to whatever comes my way, Lisa.
If you could do a book on any film, whether you've worked on it or not, what film would you pick?
Wow. That's a You know, there's just too many of them. There are so many movies that I love and that I would really be interested in reading about or writing about. You know, starting with movies of the 30s and 40s and moving to one of my favorite movies, which is one that I bonded over with Bob Gale, was The Great Escape. And I know somebody who wrote a book about The Great Escape, and I read every single word about it and wanted more. There's a lot left out there.
Do you have, I know that the strike is on and everything, but do you have anything hopeful in the pipeline for once the strike is finished, or any plans or anything that you can talk about?
Last year, I was lucky enough to work on two projects, one which had just came on Hulu, a science fiction project called No One Will Save You. That was directed by a gentleman named Brian Duffield, who had written a Netflix show that I did called The Babysitter many years ago, which was a lot of fun, and the show was great. I did a show for Apple, which has not aired yet, which is a 10-episode period piece called Palm Royale, about this group of women in Palm Beach, Florida, in the late 60s. And Palm Beach was a very ritzy, upper-class area, and these women always sort of wanted to be at the head of the table, running charity events and knowing everything, and the cast was staggeringly good, starting with Kristen Wiig and Laura Dern and Allison Janney and Carol Burnett. What an amazing show that's going to be. The amount of detail, the amount of the production itself is very rich and lavish, and I think it's going to be a fun show.
Well, you've been very amazing fielding all my questions. I have one more. If you could go back before you landed that Wes Craven film, your very mm-hmm. first film. Knowing what you know now, what advice would you give yourself, or what would you do differently?
I don't know that I do anything differently, because what I did led to this career that I have. And so have I made some mistakes here and there? Sure, everybody does. But you learn from those mistakes. So Any mistake I've made, I've only made once. But we just continue to learn through everything that we do. So I have absolutely no regrets. And, you know, as you said earlier, Back to the Future is part of my legacy. And that's a damn fine legacy to have.
I'll do a tangent question then onto that one. Anyone wanting to get into the industry as a production publicist, what advice would you give them?
The one piece of advice that I give, and people can either take it or leave it, is if you want to be in this business, you need to learn everything about it that you can, not just what you're focused on. And a big part of being in this business, in my opinion, is knowing its history. It's being able to speak intelligently about film. I tell anyone who will listen, go watch a lot of black and white films. Go watch MGM musicals. Go watch Cary Grant in the 1940s. Just immerse yourself in film. And not only will you learn stuff, you'll enjoy it. I mean, Hitchcock, and this business is so rich. And there's a reason it's been around for this long. And it keeps getting better. And we've come into a part of our history where streaming has given the opportunity for even more quality shows for both television and theaters. When I first started, the model at the studios was they would release two big films, or tent poles as they're called, a couple of very, very low budget independents, and about 5, 6, 7 mid-range budgets. And some of those films were of tremendous quality. And as time progressed, a lot of those films got lost in the formula, potentially wonderful films. And now those projects are alive again on Netflix and Amazon and any number of, you know, the streaming services. So there's more of a chance for people to learn and enjoy and experience all the genres.